morning. Welcome to the Marion County Board of Commissioners meeting. It is Wednesday, September 23rd, 2015. We're in the Senator Hearing Room here at Courthouse Square, and we will begin our meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Well, we are paperless, sort of, today. We have been working as the Board of Commissioners for a long time, and actually, we gave the direction, and a lot of other people did a lot of work to make this possible. So we have computers. We have everything on the computers. We're logged in. We have a paper backup, just in case the computers don't work for us, and we're going to muddle through today. Although Kevin is light years ahead of us because he's been working off of electronic for the past several weeks. So I just wanted to kind of let you know this is new and improved.
Be careful, Madam Chair, because I didn't even know my username to get into the computer this morning. So careful.
All right. So maybe sound years ahead of us.
I learned something new today.
Okay, very good. So we have public comment first on our agenda. We have two people that have signed up for public comment. The first is J.C. Riggs. And if you go over to the far table over here, or our camera picks you up better there. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm here today to speak about moving forward with marijuana in Oregon. And I am a hazelnut farmer. I live in Silverton, Oregon, and I live in unincorporated rural Marion County. And I would like to speak about Colorado sales. Based on July sales, Colorado has hit an all-time high, and that is in the $67 million range in 1 month alone in July. And in my, excuse me. And basically, if you guys move forward to ban and opt out in Marion County, I feel you will not get any tax revenue based on sales. And I know Marion County, you know, because I live in Marion County, would need those tax revenue. In the month of July alone, almost $900,000 in taxes went to the counties to pay for all sorts of services. So if you guys can read the information that I gave to you today and try to base your decision making on what the future will hold and the tax revenue that it will bring. It's not about getting high, it's about getting healthy. It's not just about marijuana, it's not about the THC and the things that make people get high. There's a CBD when you extract the plant, just like a THC factor, the CBDs are the health benefit of the plant. You can get those health benefits from hemp or marijuana. It's the same plant, different things. If I grew a hemp plant, and I extract it for CBDs, I can grow as much as I want with the USDA permit, and you guys can't stop that in Marion County. You can stop marijuana, and that's for people, it helps them in all sorts of ways. But the CBDs that someone can get from a marijuana plant is beneficial, just like out of a hemp plant. And I know I don't want to base all my information today on hemp. This is about marijuana. But we're going to grow it anyways in Marion County. I mean, I can grow it in greenhouses. I can grow hemp. I can grow as much as I want. I can have a minimum of 2.5 acres. Or I can grow marijuana and do it legally. I meet all the guidelines. I was a medical marijuana grower prior to July 1. And if I read this information that you guys are trying to move forward, correct, in House Bill 3400, if it affects me in the medical, when I met the guidelines, all up until it says that I wasn't a business prior to July 1, which I wasn't in business to make money. I was using and actually helping my patients get their medicine. If you guys ban it, it'll affect me moving forward to help my patients. If you ban it and opt out, it'll also just move me to a different county, and my tax money will go to a different county. I hope you guys consider not opting out. It's the best thing for the community. It's the best thing for the county. I believe if you do move it to a vote, it will pass. It's just inevitable. The numbers are staggering. And Colorado is thriving. With marijuana sales, I mean, they made $8.9 million in 1 month and almost $900,000 in county tax or taxes for the whole state of Colorado. Oregon can do the same, and it'll benefit everyone. Again, it's not about getting high. People are trying to get healthy as well. It benefits the medical marijuana user, but the rec user that never knew that it would even benefit them could use it and understand that there's the CBDs that help you, it will not get you high. There's also, they can extract that from the plant and just benefit that for health reasons. I hope you guys reconsider, and that's what I would like to say.
Thank you. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, I did. Chris, thank you for coming before us 2 weeks in a row now. I want to just clear up something. You've used "you guys can stop marijuana," and I want to be really clear that us guys, us commissioners, cannot. This is a referral to the people, and the only way that it would be stopped is if the people of Marion County vote to do that. It would not be us three up here with anything we have in our control. So I want to be really clear about that.
Well, I want to be clear as well. Sam walked up to me prior to the meeting last week, and he says, "We've stopped all that." So what does that mean then? If it's not you guys, who is it? You guys do not have to opt out. You can move forward. It's your guys' decision.
Right. It will delay until after the vote.
Correct.
That's what it will do.
Right.
But if I could, we do have two medical marijuana facilities in rural Marion County.
Okay.
And we are not stepping in front of early sales. So early sales will occur on October 1. That's why we're here today, right, in late September to put this ordinance in place so that it precedes the October 1 date. So those two facilities will be grandfathered in. So they will have both medical and recreational sales at those two facilities.
Okay.
And then in November 2016, which is what House Bill 3400 prescribes, there'll be an election. Now, in Marion County, actually, the measure failed. But it will be a countywide vote. And, you know, as you know, probably because you've been following things, and Margo, I saw you in Salem when you testified. It passed in Salem by several percentage points. It failed narrowly in all of Marion County. So that meant rural Marion County kind of tipped the more urban areas in the vote. So we'll see what happens, because not all the same people show up to vote, but it will be a presidential election, which means there'll probably be a lot of people voting, probably more people voting than voted in the election that just passed the measure itself. So the other thing to know is that we have a second ordinance that we're considering today that would put the 3% tax. So what we're saying is, you in Marion County voters, you said no the first time. Do you still mean no, or do you mean yes? All right, and so that's the vote that we're doing today. And if you mean yes, we want to go forward. We want an extra 3% for the county.
Absolutely.
Which is our right under House Bill 3400. So it's really kind of more of a vote to just make sure that the people are okay with what we're doing moving forward.
Right, and it also, when it comes to the medical marijuana grower like myself that had a small number of plants and was not in business, House Bill 3400 in the section that you're trying to opt out of and move to a vote affects me. I have to shut down my whole, I only have 24 plants, but I have to shut down according to the reading that I read, based that I wasn't a business and I wasn't registered as a business to the Secretary of State, and also that I didn't have a site application in with the county about my site plans, but I wasn't in business. So if that's the only two reasons, and I already met all the other criteria of being already, prior to July 1, a designated grower, background checked, my whole facility is fenced and secure and no minors can get in there, because I have 5 children, that would be a concern for me. I think I should hope to ask for a ban exemption if that's possible. I mean, I've seen it's done with other people. There's, like I said, I referred to the other person that's in Aurora, that they're huge in the industry. They have all their products, and I don't need to name names, but they make a vaporizer pen that has oil. They have 25,000 square feet, but because they've done their homework and they're a business making money, they can move forward in this according to what's the guidelines of you guys are setting forth.
Right.
So they can make millions of dollars, West mom and pops, and they're bringing their money out of Israel. So I'm from Oregon. I'm born and raised in Oregon. I would like not an opt-out, but if it's opted out, I would like a ban exemption if that's possible. I would like you guys to consider that. I'm a small farmer. I mean, I put all my money into my operation to move forward, and if you opt out, I mean, you have the control to give me a ban exemption, I would think, because I read it in there that other people have ban exemptions.
We'll get into that, I think, when we actually have the discussion, because I don't want to get into too many details here.
Okay, I appreciate it.
I think that changed because our measure for medical marijuana was implemented in the February session at the time that medical marijuana was being worked on at the legislature.
Okay.
But now with the passage of the voter-passed state-level initiative in House Bill 3400, I think the authority to figure out who gets to do what is with the OLCC and with the Oregon Health Authority, correct? And so...
See, I'm already licensed to the Oregon Health Authority. Yeah, I would love if that would be a consideration at a further date.
Yeah. Right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you
really
very much.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate your time.
Margo, your turn. Good morning. Would you introduce yourself for the record?
Good morning, everybody. My name is Margo Lucas, and today I'm going to represent the United Food and Commercial Workers Union, who hired me in June as a cannabis lobbyist and organizer. So I'll speak with their voice today since I don't have a dog in this particular fight. I may ask you for some clarification in a minute, if that's all right. I just wanted to say that I think the county, I'm not sure what this election is going to cost you, but I think you should heed a couple of things that the Measure 91 campaign didn't fight too hard on the ground in rural Polk County, and I think that we have unbelievable positive support on the ground. So what those numbers are going to come out in the ballot, I don't know, but I would be not surprised at all if the measure was turned down at the ballot and marijuana businesses were allowed to go ahead. I wouldn't be surprised at all by that result. I also just wanted to point out to the commission that, as I said, I'm working with the United Food and Commercial Workers Union through Local 555, and we are getting out and talking to these marijuana businesses that will be licensed retailers and trying to get them to come on board with better paying jobs, benefits, and retirement for these workers that will be at the labor intensive points will be grows and processors. And so we would just like to point that out to you because those jobs on the ground do help the economy from the ground up. And then in addition to that, there are the tax dollars as well. I think you're trying to do this carefully, and we appreciate that. I know you have put a lot of thought to our issue in the past and continue to. If I may ask a question, I'm not sure if this gentleman's medical marijuana grow would be affected by this ordinance.
I don't think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Our legal counsel says no.
So I just wanted to make some clarification.
Sales, right.
I believe we are talking about recreational licensed facilities through OLCC.
I did want to
point to you that those are labor-intensive areas of our industry, both grows and processing, and we would like to unionize those businesses and put good jobs, good-paying jobs with benefits and retirements on the ground that will help communities, and like I said, also the tax dollars. So I think I'll end it there.
Great, thank you. So Gloria did say it would also... We wouldn't have any additional dispensaries during the time period prior to the
election. I did read that clearly. Right, yeah. I just wanted to clarify for the gentleman that I don't think his current status is threatened by this. And we can talk more about that.
Okay.
But thank you.
Right, thank you. Any questions for Margo before she leaves?
No, thanks. Thanks, Margo.
All right. Anyone that came in that didn't have a chance to sign up? Looks like everyone here has a chance later, almost. Okay, so let's move to the consent calendar, and Commissioner Cameron, I believe that you are,
Madam Chair, I'm letting my fingers get onto the right place on my computer here. I would make a motion to move the consent calendar this morning under Business Services and Human Resources, approve a recommendation to establish a new classification Elections and Recording Manager in the Clerk's Office. Under Community Services, approve allocation agreement and order distributing $100,000 per year of economic development funds to the Oregon Garden Foundation through June 30th of 2018. Under Finance, approve a quick claim deed to convey real property number R58346 to the prior owner. And under Information Technology, approve the purchase order with Oracle Support Services for $183,242.15 to provide licensing and support through June 30th, 2016. Under the Tax Collector, approve an order authorizing a property tax refund of $25,965.88 to First American Bank Corp, Inc.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve those items. Any comments, discussion on any of them? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
They are all approved. Okay, we have one item under health to start us out. We've moved it first so that Rod can slip out and do something more interesting, I guess, than listen to our discussion on marijuana ordinances, and then we'll go from there.
Yes, Commissioner, I have to get back and pack. We're moving tomorrow. I'm Rod Calkins, Marion County Health Administrator, and I'd like to talk to you today about a restatement that you have before you of the intergovernmental agreement between Marion and Polk County regarding the Mid-Valley Behavior Care Network. This is a restatement of an existing intergovernmental agreement. Existing was effective July 22nd, I believe, 2014. This is basically makes a few changes to the existing agreement, and I would just want to briefly point them out to you. Under section 2.2, which is on page 1, I believe, of the restated agreement, the references to the former partners in the intergovernment agreement, Lynn and Yamhill counties, is removed, and no reference is made. The references to those counties is deleted from the current agreement because they are not partners going forward. This is just an intergovernmental agreement between Marion and Polk counties. The second change is under number 8, county budget and funding, and that's on page 6. And what that does is to clarify that the Mid-Valley Behavior Care Network is not subject to local budget law, which I think is an important thing in terms of how they set up their budget committee and publish the budget, et cetera. And the third change is under number 17, which is on page 8, which is the effective date of the agreement, which would make the effective date of this restatement November 1st or the later of that, or when both counties ratify this restatement. So that's basically it. As you know, the Mid-Valley Behavior Care Network manages the Medicaid benefit principally for mental health and chemical dependency on a regional basis in Marion and Polk County, and works closely with our local coordinated care organization, Willamette Valley Community Health, in doing so.
Hi, I'm sorry. We're having a little discussion here because we actually have a marked version that I had given so that the other commissioners could see exactly where the changes were. And I'm not seeing that. I had left that in the... but it's okay. It's always helpful to see what the language was before and what was taken out. And so that's why I provided that. But we can pass this around if you want
to
take a look at it.
So he did. Did we miss any of the changes? He described it, and I was following along here on my.
Yeah, he did describe it.
Just didn't show the red line.
Yeah, it just doesn't show what was deleted. Okay. You know, so because you only have what is now there. So it's basically technical changes, and the local budget law piece was really the only substantive piece of it, other than the technical updates. So if you're interested in seeing that, I've got a copy of that.
I'm fine with this copy here.
Okay.
I think I'm satisfied, Madam Chair, and I'd make a motion that we do approve the restated IGA between Marion County, Polk County, and the Mid-Valley Behavioral Care Network.
And I'll second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the revised intergovernmental agreement for the Behavioral Care Network. Any further discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, that's approved.
And Madam Chair, just to clarify, Rod, you're not personally moving, you're moving the whole health department, mm-hmm. right?
Just a minor little move. Yeah, half of us are actually moved. We moved this past weekend. Public health and our clinic is now down at Oak Street. And this coming weekend, we are moving the administrative piece and the adult behavioral health services and environmental health to 750 Front Street. So it's quite an undertaking. Mm-hmm. And we've got crates everywhere and there's chaos. And we're doing more recycling and purging of files than I think we've done in many decades. So looking through my own office, I found some things there that predate my tenure with the county. So,
well, thanks for going through that. It's going to be good in the long run, but it's hard right now, I'm sure.
It's a little tough. What's going to happen to the Center Street building is a lot of renovations that nothing's been done on the building since it was built in the 1970s, really. And I think it'll make it much more energy efficient, and it'll make it a lot better in terms of the services that we actually deliver to residents.
So, Rod, one question on that too. I went, the woman I advocate for, she gets her prescriptions at the pharmacy, which is now going to move to Front Street.
That's going to move
to
Front Street.
And so drove over there just to see where it was, and there's no buses on Front Street. So maybe getting information out on what the closest bus stop would be for people if they need to take public transportation there?
Yes, we were getting that information in many of our flyers, and it's I believe it's Broadway and Union.
Okay.
It's quite a ways.
Wow. It is quite a ways, yeah.
It was a little closer because it was on Commercial Street, and the bus route moved.
Right. Oh. So the other option would be, I guess, TripLink is really, really hard to get rides on now, so maybe having some discussions with them about if people are going to the pharmacy, how far it is for them to actually be able to go, right. So they can possibly prioritize those trips, something like that. Because it would be difficult for someone who has a disability or, you know, just trying to get over there.
Yes, I think we're going to have to think about what we can do to perhaps help people get from the bus stop to the clinic. But I don't know. We do have one van that we run early in the morning for our methadone services that we might be able to pick people up at stops.
Okay. Yeah, just wanted to put that on your radar screen.
It's a good point, and when we found out that the bus had moved a little bit farther away, it was concerning.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right. Moving to item number 2. Consider adoption of an ordinance prohibiting marijuana businesses in the unincorporated areas of Marion County by emergency procedure. And we have Scott Norris from Legal Counsel who's here. And Scott, if you would, I'm hoping, give us a background about where we've been as a board in this conversation and some of the policy issues that are involved with this in addition to just the technical legal issues, that would be awesome.
I'll try.
All right, thank you.
I am Scott Norris with the Office of Legal Counsel. The Oregon medical marijuana program has been in place for several years now, and medical marijuana dispensaries have been authorized for a couple of years. Then Measure 91, the voters statewide passed Measure 91, authorizing recreational marijuana, and Chair, you had mentioned the vote in Marion County on Measure 91. That measure failed in Marion County by 51.56%. The legislature in 2015 made several changes to both the medical marijuana program and Measure 91, principally in House Bill 3400. House Bill 3400, specifically in Section 134, authorizes local governments to adopt ordinances which prohibit any one or all of the six different types of marijuana businesses described in House Bill 3400 within the jurisdiction of the local government. This is what's commonly referred to as an opt-out ordinance, and that is what is before the board today. Before I move into the specifics of the proposed ordinance, I wanted to also mention that after medical marijuana dispensaries became authorized in Oregon, the board passed an ordinance establishing regulations and a permit system for medical marijuana dispensaries, and that ordinance exists today and is specific to medical marijuana dispensaries. So, against that backdrop.
Okay, before you get into the technical, let's make sure that we have all of the context out before we get into actually the substance of the measure. So are there any questions, first of all, from either of you, or comments?
Well, the other, maybe the other comment I would make is that the personal use issues are not involved in what we're doing today. Can you comment on that?
That's correct, and I was going to mention that specifically in Section 6 okay. of but, the...
No, go ahead. Let's go ahead and talk about it now, and then that will just be repeat when we go through it.
Okay. This ordinance does not and cannot affect the personal use provisions found in Measure 91 and House Bill 3400. Those provisions relate to, for example, the minimum age, that the lawful age for possessing marijuana, the amounts, lawful amounts, which an individual may possess in their home or on their person, for example. This ordinance has no effect and does not change those provisions under Oregon law.
And then, Scott, talk a bit about, also there's a provision in there about the incorporated areas of Marion County. So in Marion County, we have 20 cities, and each one of those jurisdictions is authorized under House Bill 3400 to make the same decisions that we're making for the unincorporated areas of Marion County. So in other words, do they want to put in an ordinance that would ban early sales or not? And if you do nothing, except for in the city of Salem, early sales are allowed. Then they're making also the decisions about whether they would want to opt out of any one of six different aspects of the marijuana industry. So can you just describe what that process is?
Yes, the county's ordinance does not apply within the cities. There's subsection 7 of the ordinance states that the ordinance does not affect the rights or authority of cities to prohibit or regulate marijuana businesses pursuant to House Bill 3400. Each city has same authority under House Bill 3400 to choose or not choose to pursue the opt-out option as the county does as well. So this ordinance would apply only in the unincorporated areas of the county, and each city has authority to make those decisions for themselves.
Okay, so... However, the difference between the election process in the cities and the county is what?
A measure by a city is voted on by the residents of the city. The county measure is voted on by the residents of the county at large. So both unincorporated residents and residents of the cities will vote on the the opt-out if the board chooses to adopt the opt-out ordinance.
Okay. And then the other part that I wanted you to cover in our ordinance for the ban exemption permit, since that was raised. So talk about what our plans are for that ordinance, because we've had a little bit of discussion, but the ordinance needs to be revised in the future. So some of the issues that we're going to be dealing with.
Yeah, the proposed ordinance would prohibit medical marijuana dispensaries except those that have a current ban exemption permit as of the effective date of the proposed ordinance. There are two permitted medical marijuana dispensaries in the county, in the unincorporated area of the county currently. And under the proposed ordinance, those facilities would be permitted to continue to operate.
Correct, but just to continue the thought, so because people are listening here, and so this, we're creating a record, so it's not just what I already know, all right? So the OLCC and the Oregon Health Authority are involved, so how does our current ordinance juxtapose against that new process? And then as I understood it, our ordinance is going to be somewhat obsolete, and this period that we have between now and next November is going to give us some time to go through that ordinance and to take a look at the different provisions, so that should the ballot measure fail in November and we're moving forward, or even if it passes, we have some parameters around what with which we're going to be operating on time, manner, and place. So I would like you to talk about that a bit.
Yeah, two things, I guess. There's House Bill 3400 requires, if the board passes the proposed ordinance, House Bill 3400 requires that the county notify OHA for the medical marijuana businesses which would be prohibited.
And that's the Oregon Health Authority at the state level.
And the OLCC, Oregon Liquor Control Commission, who has authority to regulate recreational marijuana businesses. That way, the those agencies will not license those types of businesses between the time of the passage of the opt-out ordinance and the November 2016 election, when the ordinance goes before the voters of the county. So that the ordinance essentially acts as a moratorium until the election. That also gives the county some time to re-examine the existing medical marijuana ordinance and see what, in particular, what OLCC will do with regard to administrative rules governing recreational marijuana businesses, and examine whether there are any additional time, manner, place restrictions relating to when or where a business can operate or be located, depending upon, of course, what rules that the state puts in place through the OLCC.
So just to elaborate on that, and so the current ordinance that we have is an ordinance only on medical marijuana, because that was what was legal when we looked at it in February of 2014, I think it was.
And specifically only on medical marijuana dispensaries.
Dispensaries, correct. And so the ban exemption permit that we did at that time addressed only marijuana. So now we have a state, as we've talked about, a state initiative that's passed at the state level, and we've had the legislature met, and we have House Bill 3400. But House Bill 3400 allows the county to, or local jurisdictions, counties and cities, to impose time, manner, and place regulations. But we don't have, on the retail side, the Oregon Liquor Control Commission has not completed their work in setting up those administrative rules. So if we were to jump in right now and try to impose time, manner, and place on recreational marijuana, and then the OLCC came out 3 months later and had something different, we would just have to come right in again and adjust our ordinance to match that. We're trying to anticipate what's going to happen. We're getting reports, and we can kind of see what's happening, but we don't know. So we don't have really, as I recall, any land use restrictions other than zones where medical marijuana dispensaries are allowed or not allowed. And the law that came in has different zones for growing and that type of thing than what our ordinance had said. We put in restrictions on hours. We put in restrictions on whether the law said for medical marijuana 1,000 feet from a school, I think. We added daycare centers and parks. And so if the state regulations then end up being different than those regulations, again, it wouldn't make sense for us to come in and impose that a recreational marijuana facility can't be 1,000 feet from a park if the OLCC comes in and says it can be 2,000 feet from a park or 500 feet or no feet. So we need to be able to see what the state is doing before we do that. And then also because there's so many other aspects to recreational marijuana, in term, it was not considered a crop under the medical marijuana sort of conceptual framework, I guess, at the legislation. And now the law specifically says it is a crop, right? So then that kind of puts everything in a different mode as you're looking at land use. So all of those things have to be considered and worked out. And this will give us some time to see what the state is doing, have our land use folks consult and work so we can, as Margo said, thoughtfully move forward on this and put in the framework that we want in Marion County, given that we are a very large agricultural county. And so we want to make sure that we're doing all of this in a way that's going to be best for the citizens of Marion County.
And there, it may well end up where the OLCC's regulations governing recreational marijuana address the concerns, time, manner, place sorts of concerns that the board may have. Then again, there may be areas that the OLCC does not regulate, does not mention in their regulations that the board may wish to address.
Right, and we would reiterate probably the OLCC's time, manner, and place in our ordinance, and then determine whether or not we want to overlay anything that's unique to Marion County, that the board and with a lot of public input is going to figure out.
And likewise, with the passage of House Bill 3400, there could well be some new land use measures, land use regulations coming out of DLCD, which could potentially require some further analysis from the county.
Commissioner, I know you wanted to say something.
Well, just I want to clarify for some of the public testimony we had earlier. So the only thing that this measure does when it comes to medical marijuana is it just puts a moratorium on any more dispensaries until after the vote. It doesn't change any of the medical marijuana laws as far as growing for people and et cetera, et cetera. So anybody who's doing something today with under the medical marijuana laws, they will still be able to continue that. Would that be correct?
That is correct. The proposed ordinance would prohibit the six types of marijuana businesses described in House Bill 3400. It would not affect, for example, it would not affect cardholders under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program or growers under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program, because they are not licensed as businesses as described in House Bill 3400.
And then just another point to make, that if there are businesses, grow sites right now that are growing for recreational and distributing them, they've kind of jumped the gun. Is that right?
That would be correct.
Okay.
Because OLCC has not written their regulations yet of those types of businesses, there are no licensed recreational marijuana businesses at this time.
Right. So that's coming up December, January, potentially, right?
Those regulations are expected somewhere around the start of the year.
Right.
I just see our planner smiling in the back.
Right. Well, it's going to be an interesting job trying to figure out where these places are and what they're doing and what aspect of the business that they're involved in. But we would hope that people would follow the law and start when the law says it's okay to start. And if this ordinance today, if we pass that today, that would delay that until after the vote for any recreational grow site, correct?
That is correct, yeah. As I mentioned earlier, this ordinance, the proposed opt-out ordinance would effectively act as a moratorium on these types of businesses between now and the November 2016 general election.
And I did find those slides that you had. We had a work session, looks like on August 27th, and Marion County, the measure failed, Measure 91 failed in Marion County by 51.5, looks like 6 or 8. 6%?
5.6.
I believe it's 51.56%.
Right. So that's what I said narrowly. And Margo, how much did it pass by in Salem? You had that statistic.
I don't remember.
54 or something like 53? Right, yeah, in that range. So it passed in Salem by 53 to 54%, but failed countywide by slightly over 51%.
So, Madam Chair, maybe just for clarification, under Section 6, can we refer to Section 6 right now, Scott?
Sure.
It says, Section 6 says, no effect on personal use provisions, which we clarified. This ordinance does not affect the provisions regarding personal use of recreational marijuana found in Chapter 1 on. Could we, as we are sitting here, just to clarify, could we add also a reference to personal use for medical marijuana provisions?
Sure. Yes, we could, because this ordinance does not and cannot affect use of medical marijuana.
Yeah. By not adding it, I mean, we're still saying it's okay, but by adding it, it just clarifies for people who are concerned about that we're not changing anything that's out there. Madam Chair, are you all right with
that?
Yeah,
I'm fine with that.
And me too.
So what would the language be? Let's
where it says personal, you could say or medical.
Maybe we have legal counsel.
Use of recreational marijuana found in Chapter 1, and it would be or medical.
I would perhaps suggest at the end of that of the sentence in Section 6, add or the use or growing of medical marijuana under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program.
Or the use or growing of medical marijuana under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program?
Correct. Okay. That's what I would suggest.
Okay. That works. Gloria nods?
Yes.
Okay.
I see a comment.
All right. And Margo, why don't you go over and sit by Scott, because we need to pick you up in a microphone. I know it's not a public hearing. We don't usually allow people from the audience.
Thank you. I just wanted to point out one other area where there may be some confusion and maybe add some clarification. There is something in your ordinance that refers to medical marijuana processors. So for clarification, there is no provision under the OMMP statutes for processors, just patients, growers, and caregivers. So just for clarification there, because it does say that language is in there for medical marijuana processors. And I don't know exactly, maybe this gentleman can point the exact notation. Just for clarification.
Right, we just need to know, thank you, Margo. We probably better not have people coming back and forth, but thank you for that.
Right. Well, just for clarification, because you were saying it wasn't going to affect medical marijuana. But
right. I'm not seeing where it says that in the ordinance, so, okay. It says marijuana processors, but that's Measure 91.
Marijuana processing sites. The marijuana processing site is a new creation under House Bill 3400 That is specific to medical marijuana processing, and is a new type of licensed business under Section 85 of House Bill 3400, and is one of the six types of marijuana businesses described in House Bill 3400, which Section 134 of House Bill 3400 allows local governments to opt out of.
Okay. All right, so why don't we go ahead then and walk through the ordinance, unless there are any further questions on the content and process. No, I think we need to go through it section by section. Okay. So.
Right.
And starting with the heading of it, so that everybody's clear on what it is.
The caption states that the ordinance prohibits the establishment of marijuana businesses in the unincorporated area of Marion County, refers the ordinance to the electors of Marion County, and declares an emergency under the emergency procedure for adoption of ordinances. Section 1 of the ordinance states the purpose of this ordinance is to prohibit marijuana processing sites, medical marijuana dispensaries, except those holding a current medical Marion County medical marijuana dispensary ban exemption permit, marijuana producers, marijuana processors, marijuana wholesalers, and marijuana retailers in the unincorporated areas of Marion County, pursuant to Section 134 of House Bill 3400. The first two of those types of businesses, marijuana processing sites and medical marijuana dispensaries, relate to medical marijuana, and the latter four, marijuana producers, processors, wholesalers, and retailers, relate to recreational marijuana, originally established under Measure 91. Section 2 contains definitions of marijuana and marijuana producer, processor, wholesaler, and retailer as those terms are defined in House Bill 3400, and then defines marijuana processing site as a processing site for medical marijuana. There is no definition for a marijuana processing site in 3400, but in the context of Section 85, which describes the licensing process, it is clear that these are for medical marijuana processing.
Right, and if I could, Scott, I've just found Rob Bovet from AOC, Association of Oregon Counties, in his brief summary, talks about it's more of a tracking issue, requires the registration and tracking of all grow sites, processing sites, and dispensaries in the OHA database.
So, correct.
Right.
Section 3 is the prohibition section, and specifically prohibiting marijuana processing sites, and these are all in the unincorporated areas of Marion County. Marijuana processing sites registered under Section 85 of House Bill 3400. Medical marijuana dispensaries registered with the Oregon Health Authority under ORS 475.314, except for the entities holding a current Marion County medical marijuana dispensary ban exemption permit, which are issued pursuant to Chapter 5.25 of the Marion County Code, on or before the effective date of the ordinance. And then the other four recreational marijuana types of businesses, marijuana producers, processors, wholesalers, and retailers, which are licensed under Sections 19 through 22 of Measure 91. Section 4 requires the referral of this ordinance to the electors of Marion County at the next general election, which is on Tuesday, November 8, 2016. That provision is required under House Bill 3400. Likewise, Section 5 is required by House Bill 3400, requiring that the ordinance be provided to Oregon Health Authority and to the Oregon Liquor Control Commission. As discussed previously, the purpose of that is so that those agencies do not license any of these types of marijuana businesses, at least until after the November 2016 election. Section 6, as we discussed, states that the ordinance does not affect the provisions regarding personal use of recreational marijuana found in Measure 91 and House Bill 3400. As I had mentioned, that relates to things like minimum age, lawful quantities that you can have in your home or on your person, for example. And then we've added language, this ordinance does not affect the use or growing of medical marijuana under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program. Section 7, as we had discussed, states that the ordinance does not affect the rights or authority of cities to prohibit or regulate marijuana businesses pursuant to House Bill 3400. As we had discussed, this ordinance only applies within the unincorporated area of Marion County, and the cities have their own authority to act pursuant to House Bill 3400 if they choose. Finally, this ordinance is proposed to be adopted by emergency procedure, which means that upon reading the caption of the ordinance twice, the ordinance may take effect immediately. And if there are any questions.
Kevin. Questions?
Do we want to read into the record what the no effect on personal use language is now? Since we can't edit this here, you want to read that?
I can read that. I'll read it in its entirety.
Right. I think that's a good idea, mm-hmm. So that the public will know as we're doing this.
As revised, it will read as follows. This ordinance does not affect the provisions regarding personal use of recreational marijuana found in Chapter 1, Oregon Laws 2015, paren, Measure 91, close paren, and Chapter 614, Oregon Laws 2015, paren, House Bill 3400, 2015. Close paren, or the use or growing of medical marijuana under the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program.
Thank you.
Period.
Does that work?
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. And the other thing I wanted to bring up, I'm just going through these papers here that from these prior work sessions and discussions that we've had. So as of a week ago, Monday, when we had our Association of Oregon Counties meetings, there were 6 counties that have given notice that they're doing the local opt-out. 5 of them are in eastern Oregon, Umatilla, Harney, Malheur, Crook, and Wheeler. So none of those counties, because the Measure 91 failed by more than 5% or more in those counties. So the county commissioners under House Bill 3400 have the option of just basically imposing it by ordinance rather than putting it out to the vote of the people. And so they've all opted not to put it out on the general election and just to do that by ordinance. Douglas County is the only county on the west side that has so far given notice prior to us, or unless someone did it in the last week and a couple days, to be put on the ballot in the general election. And then there are a number of cities, I think I counted 17 cities, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 10. I think it's 17. Now most of them are on the east side, Ontario, Vail, Nyssa. I don't know where Island City is. Anyone know where that is?
LeGrand.
Okay, John Day. Now, some of these are, though, when you look, Brownsville is down in the valley, Sandy, Junction City, Cresswell, Sweet Home, and then you've got Manzanita, Adrian, Elgin, Baker City, City of Umatilla. But one of the interesting things that came up in that discussion, too, is that all of these jurisdictions that are either imposing opt-out by ordinance because of the way the law is structured or putting on the ballot are opting out of all of the different aspects of it. And part of that is tied to the fact that the law as it's written right now says that if you opt out of any part, you don't get the tax. So jurisdictions are saying, well, we might as well just opt out of all of it because why would we have a part of it and yet not get tax revenue to help us do the enforcement? So Rob Bovet also said that he was going to go back in the 2016 session and we authorized him to do that as a legislative committee and see if he could work with the different parties on perhaps amending that part. So if that part happened, we may, since it's going to be a long time between now and the time that we actually place this on the ballot, there may be a discussion at that point about whether we want to continue doing all six or whether we do like recreational but not medical, or you know, however that might work. So
yeah, as House Bill 3400 is currently drafted, a local government may opt out of any one or all of the six types of marijuana businesses, but if a local government does opt out of any one of the six medical marijuana businesses, the local government does not get a share of the state tax revenue and is not allowed to enact a local option tax as described in House Bill 3400.
Right. So just an interesting thing to think about. Okay, well, we have an ordinance in front of us. Is there any discussion? I imagine that you want to say something about it.
Well, I can go ahead and start now. Probably more appropriate after a motion, but my thinking on this from the beginning is everybody has their prejudices. Mine is I didn't want Marion County to be a center of the marijuana industry. We can only affect the unincorporated areas in this actions we're taking today. But if people agree with that statement, they'll have the opportunity to vote. And if they decide that after watching for a year or two that it's tilting windmills or whatever, they can vote no, but they also have the ability to see what real effects it has and then make the decision if they don't want to be affected or even inundated with their farms and their homes in the rural areas. Again, the only area we control. So they can agree or disagree. But in the meantime, what we'd be doing is making sure that there's no great expansion. Those that we have rumors of that are illegal today will be illegal tomorrow, and I assume the county will look into that. And so we reserve that time and not make it a moot issue when it's time for the election and have all these operations going, and then what? Try to remove them, try to listen to the grandfather. If we want to have an effect, it'd be to do it now, and then in a year they can make their decision and go from there. But we're reserving that right to make a choice for our rural residents, and I think it's our obligation to do that.
Yeah, thank you, Commissioner. Madam Chair, I know that we probably would rather have this vote sooner than later, but the House Bill 3400 is prescribing us to wait till next November of 2016. So that's kind of out of our hands as well. But I'm concerned with our agricultural being the number one agricultural producer in the state of Oregon, and we have the Marion County Farm representative from the Marion County Farm Bureau with us today, that we do go about this very slowly and methodically and think about how it's going to impact some of the other things that we need to continue to do, the food and the things we grow here in Marion County that keep people healthy are going to be important to protect. So we'll have to see how this all plays out. And again, the voters get to decide next November, and whatever the voters will is the second time around, we'll honor that as elected officials. And I guess it's my turn to make a motion, if you're ready for that, Madam Chair. Mm-hmm. What's that? Yeah. So the motion that I would make is that we consider an adoption of an ordinance prohibiting marijuana businesses in unincorporated areas of Marion County by emergency procedure, and that the chair would read it by title only twice.
Okay, so that's your first motion.
Right.
The chair reads it by title only twice. Is there
second?
A second? All right, there's a motion and a second that the chair read this ordinance by title only twice. All in favor say aye.
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 And I'll go ahead and read it by title only twice. An ordinance prohibiting the establishment of marijuana businesses in the unincorporated area of Marion County, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County and declaring an emergency. Second time, an ordinance prohibiting the establishment of marijuana businesses in the unincorporated area of Marion County, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County and declaring an emergency.
No. Madam Chair, I'll move that we adopt an ordinance prohibiting marijuana businesses in unincorporated areas of Marion County by emergency procedure.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to approve the ordinance, and not much left for me to say. You both made the points that I would have made, except that I do need to say that I have heard from people on both sides of this issue. So we have received emails from folks and testimony here for us to move forward and to not put this on the ballot. I also have received emails and have had conversations with people that are very much wanting us to put this on the ballot. So the people are divided. That was definitely shown in the vote, 51%. That means half the people roughly were for it and half the people were against it. And so I think it makes sense for us to check in with our electorate here in Marion County to make sure that we're on the right path. The other part that hasn't been discussed is that we have had discussions with our sheriff in the numbers of meetings that we have with him, Community Corrections Board and in other venues, and also the Public Safety Coordinating Council with the Salem Police Chief. And I know that our public safety officials are very concerned about how this is going to play out, what the enforcement is going to look like. I mean, even now, we're not sure where things are illegally at this point, and when things become legal and illegal and at mushrooms, I think that creates even more enforcement issues. So what appeals to me about this is that we're slowing down the process, and as was said already, then others will step forward and kind of test the waters. It really isn't as long as it feels. I mean, OLCC is not going to have their rules in place until January. We would have to have an ordinance right after that, which would take a few weeks at least to do. And so we're looking at maybe 11 months, probably at the most, in terms of a delay, which in the scope of life is not, I mean, people will live, I think. So so that's my feeling about it.
I have one more comment.
Sure.
This isn't new and it was referred to, but it's just going to be a confusing election in that the entire county will vote on it, even though it only affects the unincorporated areas. And that just seems strange. But the entire county will weigh in and make that decision. But it's strange to me that you vote on something outside of what affects you.
Right. But that is the way the legislation was made, and there are stranger things that happen in the Capitol, right? Okay.
I haven't been there in a long time. Right. Yeah.
You don't own it anymore. Huh? All right. So any further discussion? Those in favor of
I know in our motion we didn't say that we did amend the.
That's true.
We did amend as amended,
right.
And we read that into the record, so I think we're good there.
All right, so we're passing this ordinance as amended.
Right.
Thank you for that.
And I agree too.
And it agrees to that. So all in favor of that motion, say aye.
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 And that passes. Thank you. All right, Scott, you're still in the hot seat. We have a second ordinance, and this is establishing the 3% tax on the sale of recreational marijuana and referring this ordinance to the voters at the same election, November 8th, 2016 general election. So tell us about this one.
And I'm still Scott Norris from the Office of Legal Counsel. House Bill 3400 in Section 34A allows local governments to impose a local option tax on the sale of recreational marijuana items. The tax is not allowed to be greater than 3%. Similar to the opt-out ordinance, a local option tax on marijuana items must be referred to the voters at the next general election. Also, as we had discussed previously, the local government, if a local government opts out of any of the six types of marijuana businesses authorized by House Bill 3400, then a local option tax cannot go into effect. So, as the proposed local option tax is drafted, it would take effect only if the voters of Marion County were to reject the opt-out ordinance that would be going on the November 2016 election, along with the proposed local option tax. Looking at the specifics of the ordinance, first of all, the caption states that this is an ordinance establishing a 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items by persons holding a license under Section 22 of Measure 91 in the unincorporated area of Marion County, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County and declaring an emergency similar to the opt-out ordinance. Section 1 states that the purpose of the ordinance is to establish a 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items by persons holding a license under Section 22 of Measure 91, that is marijuana retailers, within the unincorporated area of Marion County, pursuant to Section 34A of House Bill 3400. This ordinance can take effect only if the voters of Marion County reject the prohibition of marijuana businesses at the November 8, 2016 general election. Section 2 contains definitions of marijuana businesses, specifically the six types of marijuana businesses that we've gone through previously, and includes definition of marijuana items, which is defined in Section 1 of House Bill 3400, and defines taxpayer as a marijuana retailer licensed under Section 22 of Measure 91. Section 3 is the tax provision. It states that in accordance with Section 34A of House Bill 3400, Marion County imposes a 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items by a person holding a license under Section 22 of House Bill 3400 in the unincorporated area of Marion County. There's a mistake on my part. There's no Section 4 in this draft. Section 5 is the referral section, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County at the next general election on Tuesday, November 8, 2016. Section 6 states when the ordinance takes effect, specifically that the ordinance can take effect only if the voters of Marion County reject the prohibition of marijuana businesses at the November 8, 2016 general election. And finally, like the opt-out ordinance, this ordinance is proposed to be adopted by emergency procedure, whereby the board reads the caption of the ordinance twice, and the result of which is the ordinance would take effect immediately upon passage. If there's any questions.
So this looks great content-wise. So in terms of the section numbers, we can just fix that before we sign the final version.
Yes.
Then it looks like there's a date.
I just saw that as I was reading.
Section 6, which will become Section 5. All right.
Yep.
So essentially this is the 3% tax only if the other measure fails.
Excuse me, what date were you talking about? Because it doesn't in 6. Is that what you're getting at? It doesn't really say then when it takes effect. It just mentions the election. So should it more specifically say on November 9th or nothing? Okay.
the election date is incorrect.
Oh. Right, but I think what Commissioner Brenten was asking is, should we actually say that it would take effect 2 days after the election or a week after the election or what?
It will take effect after the election is certified, which is up to 30 days.
Okay.
Should it say that there or is implied?
When it's referred, the measure that will actually be the referral, the ballot title.
It will say exactly when it takes effect. All right, that's fine. Okay. So any other questions on this measure?
Maybe just a comment. I've never looked at this as a great source of money for Marion County. In fact, if it's just me, I probably wouldn't take it. But we do have some expenses that are going to happen if this is approved, and even as probably even if it isn't, in terms of impacts that our sheriff, public works planning, and an ability to recover that money makes sense to me.
Right, and so what was I going to say on this? So the tax issue is interesting because the counties get, counties and cities get 10%, or counties get 10% and cities get 10%?
Each. Counties, under the
state
distribution
tax.
Of the state tax, counties get 10% and cities get 10%.
But that's after the state expenses are all met. So the state expenses get taken off the top, and then the remaining money gets divided up, and cities get 10%, counties get 10%, and the state essentially gets the rest. Is that right? With maybe a little bit.
Yeah,
of...
it. I'm not going to remember all of them, but
right.
If I remember correctly, 40% goes to the Common School Fund. There's a percentage that goes to Oregon State Police. Mm-hmm. I forget what the. I think it's 10%, but I.
Right.
I
you
do
don't,
not
we don't
recall
need to worry
correctly,
about
but
that.
There's yeah the distribution is unchanged. House Bill 3400 did not change the distribution of state tax revenue from Measure 91.
Right, and then there is some question. Rob Bovette raised this at Association of Oregon Counties about how the county distribution formula is worked, which we won't get into because I don't understand it. But the bottom line that he said was that it's basically disproportionate amongst different jurisdictions, so it doesn't align the amount of tax the jurisdiction gets with the amount of business or workload or whatever that they will likely have based on the measure. So that's something also that they'll be looking at, RAOC will be taking to the 2016 session to try to fix in the legislation.
Yeah, those provisions are all unchanged from Measure 91 and...
Right, so then this is a 3% of business just in the unincorporated area?
Yes.
Of Marion County.
It's a 3% sales tax in the unincorporated area on marijuana retailers.
Right. And there was an interesting discussion, just to add that, in the city of Salem, because they have approved up to a 10% local tax, and their attorney believes that. And they're different than counties. Cities are, some counties, I think 9-10 counties in Oregon, operate under a home rule charter, but Marion County operates under statute. So we don't have quite the same home rule authority that a city would have, like the city of Salem. And a lot of their conversation really revolved around their rights under their charter to be able to do the things that they think they can do. Their attorney thinks that they can collect up to the 10%, but the statute clearly caps a local tax at 3%, and ours is capped at 3% here, but it could be different in different jurisdictions depending on how they interpret how the law applies to them.
And ultimately, presumably, that's something that will have to get resolved probably in the courts.
So it would be 7% more on one side of Lancaster than the other.
Right. It's just an interesting situation. It'll be in court, no matter what, and then we'll figure it all out, right? So, any further discussion on this ordinance? Do we have a...
I'd make a motion to approve a reading of this ordinance by title only twice.
I'll second.
So we have a motion and a second for the chair to read the ordinance by title only twice. Those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 And I got to read it by title only twice. An ordinance establishing a 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items by persons holding a license under Section 22, Chapter 1, Oregon Laws 2015, or Measure 91, in the unincorporated area of Marion County, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County and declaring an emergency. Second time, an ordinance establishing a 3% tax on the sale of marijuana items by persons holding a license under Section 22, Chapter 1, Oregon Laws 2015, Measure 91, in the unincorporated area of Marion County, referring the ordinance to the electors of Marion County and declaring an emergency.
And I'd like to make a motion to approve the ordinance.
As amended with
as
the
amended.
Technical errors.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the ordinance, and we had changing sections 5, 6, 7, and 8 to 4, 5, 6, and 7. And then in the current section 6, changing the date from November 8th, 2015 to November 8th, 2016 for the general election. So any discussion on this ordinance? Ready for vote? All in favor say aye.
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 It's approved. Thank you, Scott.
There
was one comment I was going to make, and I've almost forgotten. That is that initially Scott was trying to put collection provisions in this, and that's still also up in the air, because what I learned at the Association of Oregon Counties is that while the Department of Revenue believes they have the authority to collect for local jurisdictions, and the legislators that passed it believe they have the authority, somehow the Oregon Department of Justice does not believe they have the authority, and they rule. So that's another piece that's going to have to go to the 2016 session and be clarified. So that it overtly, whatever the word is, says that Department of Revenue has that collection authority.
Yeah, the bill that establishes the state tax authority, House Bill 2041, says specifically that Department of Revenue has the authority to collect the state tax. But
not for local jurisdictions.
But there's no similar
language,
right,
with
regard to local option taxes for local governments.
Right. So it didn't state it outright, and there's nothing prohibiting it, but you know, it's one of those things where they just want it. Right. Lawyers, yeah, right. Okay. Thanks, Scott.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gloria says lawyers. That's good. Okay. So we are now under Board of Commissioners. And it's consider approval of a resolution opposing the creation of a new national monument proposed as the, okay, help me say this, Owyhee Canyonlands Monument within southern Malheur County, Oregon. This has my name on it. The same meeting that I've been talking about that I went to a week ago Monday, the Association of Oregon Counties meeting, the commissioners were presented with a draft ordinance. Malheur County is asking for other counties' support and opposing the creation of a new national monument. It's 2.5 million acres. Most of the information, and I don't know, it's quite a long, do we want to read the resolution?
If I could, it's pretty simple to me. Right. It's taking grounds, lands out of production and access, and if the local authority isn't in favor, I'd certainly support that and would support this resolution.
Right, so they talk, I think rather than reading it, I'll just kind of go through the facts, unless
Fine.
We want to read the whole thing. So it's a proposed 2.5 million acre national monument, 47% federal lands in Malheur County. It's 1.6 times larger than all the private lands in Malheur County. Impacts on the economy will include impacts to mining, natural gas exploration, cattle production, hunting and fishing, burdens on search and rescue, loss of county property tax revenue, rural schools, possible closure, impacts to ranchers,
Loggers.
Agriculture, cattle industries, and ancillary companies, wildlife threats, more dry vegetation, loss of jobs for firefighters with the BLM, and you mentioned timber, I didn't see it here, but anyway, so in a show of solidarity with Malheur County, this is on our agenda today for our consideration.
Just for history's sake, since I've been here, there's been moves in Marion County for the same thing. Somebody draws a line and decides to take that out, and I oppose that for us, and I certainly oppose it for somebody else.
Madam Chair, I'll move approval of a resolution opposing the creation of a new national monument proposed as the Owyhee Canyonlands Monument within southern Malheur County, Oregon.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 All right, it's approved.
Thank you.
So we'll move now to Public Works. Consider approval of a purchase in the amount of $210,000 for an airplane hangar for Capital Community Television, Vehicle and Equipment Storage. And we have Alan Haley, our Public Works Director, and Alan Bichong. We are so pleased to see you outside the door there, where we're usually in the back room subbing for Mark Hernandez. So appreciate you being here today.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Alan Haley, Public Works Director and Cable Officer for Marion County. We're here before you for approval to seek approval to purchase an airline hangar for purposes of storage of the production equipment from CCTV. As you know, they were in a new facility, but when the new facility was built, some other changes had to be made, and the parking ability in that building was removed. So the equipment is currently stored out on Silverton Road, and at an annual price of around $1,700 per year. But the space provides no ability for actually maintenance of the vehicles. They can do no training out there. The training has to happen actually out in front of CCTV. The hangar is a pull-through facility, so there'll be no backing up. So you can pull in and then pull out. It provides a great deal of space for the main production vehicle as well as the other equipment that CCTV has. It's located, obviously, at the airport, much closer than the Silverton Road facility. We have run this through the budget process with the Cable Regulatory Commission, and they have approved moving it forward for the City Council and the Board of Commissioners to consider. Alan Bichong, the Executive Director of CCTV, is here, and open for comments from him.
Well, first of all, Commissioners, it's nice to see you, and thank the SOHA is able to cover the meeting today, and it's always nice to be here. This is a proposal we really like. It solves not only our vehicle parking issues now, but we're in the process of putting a second production unit in place, and we have a mobile media lab under development right now. So it's a great space. I love doing the training. I don't know about anybody else, but when you're doing training out on Trade Street, you always wonder. Drivers are not always the most careful as they pass us. So we hope that this works for both Salem and Marion County because for us it's a very good multifunctional long-term solution, and the cost is also really good.
Thank you. Any questions for
Alan? Just a couple of comments. One, parking four of these vehicles was planned and original construction was taken out, but they've had to deal with it by parking these vehicles on the street there, I assume 24 hours a day or whenever they're not off site. And so that'll go away and get them secure and out of the weather, everything else, and literally off the street appeals to me.
And if I could add, I'm at CCTV often, or have been in the past number of years. And I think I was there when the large trailer was parked on the street and nobody was out there watching it because people were busy. And I went inside and said, so is that safe? And everybody was like, oh yeah, yeah, no. But you know, there's camera equipment on there and all of that kind of thing. So I think the security part for me too, in addition to just those cars whizzing by when they go really, you're right, they do go really fast. And the size of that vehicle and how it kind of blocks visibility. So, I mean, it's a two-way issue. It's an issue for you, and it's also an issue for the traffic. This is going to resolve a lot of those concerns. And I think it's important to point out, I mean, we rely so heavily on CCTV right now to get our word out and for the Marion County Today, the program that we're doing, and programs we've done in the past, and our reentry breakfast and all of that. But really, the mission of CCTV is your volunteers and training people, and because you couldn't do what you do with the very capable but small staff that you have to get all of the work done that you do. So having that training capacity is just critical, so I appreciate that.
Thank you, Commissioner Carlson. Really, volunteers are our oxygen. They're really what drives us. This is going to be a tremendous facility for the purposes of training, and we don't have to limit training to the 5 months a year when we are guessing that it's not going to rain. And as Commissioner Brentano says, having the truck out in front, not only is that difficult, but the idea that we can pull in from the back and then drive out the front, nothing good ever comes from backing up a 37-foot vehicle. The best you can do is to avoid doing something bad. So we're very interested in this proposal and hope, again, that it works for Marion County and the City of Salem.
Madam Chair, if I could then, noting that we have a partnership with Salem, they'll have to approve it too, but I'd make a motion that we do approve the purchase in the amount of $210,000 for an airplane hangar for Capital Community Television.
Well, I guess I'll second the motion.
Well, let's hear the rest of it.
Well, I'm just wondering if this is a conspiracy theory that Public Works wants an airplane or something.
Oh.
Well, there is a part. I don't know how it has anything to do with that. But when I was reading the packet, it talked about how there's an opportunity to sublet a portion of it to maybe offset some costs. And do you have any sense about what proportion of the facility would be sublet and what purposes and that kind of thing? Or is it just conceptual right now?
We've talked about literally splitting it in half in the City of Salem. This is a 6,500 square foot facility. This is big. So the City of Salem could park their airport vehicles, which is also going to help them reduce their maintenance. And of course, we have electronic equipment in our vehicles. So getting it out of the elements is really critical. And not all the money details have been worked out between the land lease costs and then rental back to the City of Salem. But the hangar will be used for a lot of vehicles, and I think to good purpose. And Commissioner Carlson, you're correct. There are some details that still need to be worked out.
That was a second.
But Alan's not getting an airplane anytime soon.
Drones.
Or
maybe the drones.
I am with Public Works, but this is a different hat.
Right, okay. All right.
I could use the airplane, though.
Okay. So we'll get you VPN instead, so you can email. All right, so we have a motion and a second to approve the purchase of the airplane hangar for $210,000 for Capital Community Television in conjunction with the City of Salem. Those in favor of that motion say aye.
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 All right, that is passed. Thank you. Thanks, Alan, again, for being here this morning.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Commissioners.
Alan and Alan.
Thank you both.
So we will now open a public hearing. It was noticed at 9:30. It's almost 10:30, so we're well into our notice period. This is under Public Works. It's a public hearing to consider amendments to the Marion County Code, Title 16 Urban Zone Code. And Joe Fenimore is here handing out paper. Joe, did you not get the memo?
I did. At 8 o'clock this morning, I found
out. All right. Okay. Well, we'll forgive you.
I'm sorry this wasn't in your pack. I never thought about it.
I got paper all stacked in front of me.
I don't think they told us how we'd have found
it anyway.
I've got
no room here. So.
Pretty happy to have something I can hold.
All right.
All right. Good morning, Commissioners. For the record, Joe Fenimore. On August 26, 2015, the board adopted resolution 1542 initiating a revision to the Marion County Code, Urban Code, and scheduled a public hearing for today. The purpose of the revision is to reconcile the zone code with Ordinance 1357 regarding the keeping of chickens on land inside urban growth boundaries under Marion County jurisdiction. Ordinance 1357 allows a property owner to keep hens in a single-family residential urban development zone properties while the zone code at 1625-200A11 prohibits the keeping of poultry in residential zones. I provide you a copy of that chapter to show you where this provision is buried. The chapter's title is Permitted Uses Generally. Under section 25200, it says permitted secondary and accessory structures and uses. Under item A, it says the following structures and uses are permitted on a lot in any zone in conjunction with the permitted dwelling or mobile home. Then it lists things such as a sauna, a hobby shop, fallout shelters, etc. We get down to item 11, and it says pets. Provided a conditional use is required, a conditional use permit is required if there are more than 10 mammals over 4 months old, no birds or fur-bearing animals other than pets, and no livestock, poultry, or beekeeping are permitted in residential zones. In order to reconcile the zone code with Ordinance 1357, staff recommends that this section of the zone code be amended by adding language to the second sentence. So the second sentence will now read, no birds or fur-bearing animals other than pets and no livestock or poultry other than hens as outlined in Ordinance 1357 or beekeeping in residential zones or permitted in residential zones. The board has the option to continue the public hearing, close the public hearing and leave the record open, or close the public hearing and approve, deny, or modify the proposed amendment. Staff recommends the board adopt the amendment as proposed. And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions for Joe?
Got a song for him.
I was going to ask if you're going to play that rooster song. You still got that?
I still got it.
All right.
I have the chicken dance in mind. Would that work?
I'd like to see that. I wouldn't want to hear it.
Okay.
Well, before that, let me just state that we had a public hearing sign-up sheet. We are now down to the commissioners and staff, Joe, Genoa, and Ken. So unless Genoa or Ken want to testify on the chicken ordinance here, what are we calling this?
I'm seeing some interest.
The urban zone code update. All right. There's no one signed up. And I don't think we got any emails or written comments on it.
I've got no comments. I got a phone call from the city of Donald.
City of Donald was curious about it, or?
We notified all the cities because it is an urban zone code amendment. Right. And they didn't want to know what effect it had on them. There is no residential zone property in Donald outside city limits, so it really had no effect.
Okay. Great. So we'd need a motion to close the public hearing and then.
Madam Chair, I'll move that we close the public hearing and adopt the proposed amendments to the, what is this? The
urban zone.
Urban zone, right.
Let's see what he says here.
Urban zone code update.
I'll second it.
All right, there's a motion and a second to close the public hearing and to adopt the amendments to the urban zone code as described by Mr. Fenimore. Any further discussion? Those in favor of the motion say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
And that is passed. Thank you.
Passed. I'll bring an ordinance back in a couple weeks.
All right.
Thank you.
So that concludes our business this morning. And of course, now I have buried my calendar in a pile of paper here that I was only going to have two.
I've got one here. We've got lots.
Is it online here? Can, yes. I just
at the top.
All right, let me find it here. I should be able to do this. There it is. All right, so I'll go ahead and read the, oh, this is the Monday to Friday calendar though. Is this the Wednesday to Wednesday?
Yeah,
so we don't have the right calendar on the top, so I'll go ahead and read this. So this is Wednesday. We're just completing our board session at 9 o'clock here in the Senator Hearing Room. And at 2:30, we've got the rooster song going here in the background. This is very lovely. There's a meeting of the Governor's Reentry Council. This is the State Reentry Council at the Department of Public Safety Standards and Training on Almsville Highway in Salem. On the 25th, Friday at 7:30 in the morning, is a meeting of the Mid-Valley Workforce Board, and the Jobs Council is meeting in conjunction with that. That's at the Kaiser Civic Center in the Iris Room, 930 Shimawa Road, Northeast in Salem. Monday, September 28th at 8:15 in the morning, is new employee orientation welcome. And I can just guess who's going to be there because I think you're it.
I'm here.
And that'll be held in the HR training room on the fourth floor here at Courthouse Square at 555 Court Street, Northeast in Salem. At 8:30 is, I think we've canceled Commissioner's calendar review and management update on Monday. Is that correct?
I'll be there.
Yeah, Kevin should go.
Oh, I guess we left it on because we could call in. So it's still an open question. So I think right. It's still on the calendar for that. And so Board of Commissioners calendar review at 8:30 in the Silverton Conference Room, fifth floor Courthouse Square, followed by management update, fifth floor Courthouse Square, but possibly going to be canceling both of those meetings. And then in the evening on September 28th, Monday from 6 to 7 p.m., is a follow-up meeting at Elkhorn at the Fire Department, 32788 North Ford Road, Southeast in Lyons. And then next Wednesday, there is no board session. So we'll have to practice using this paperless system after 2 weeks, which is really dangerous because you're supposed to have regular routine follow-ups in order for it to stay in your brain. So we'll just have to wing it 2 weeks from now. So that's the calendar. Anything else?
Well, I do have one. I kind of hate to announce it in a way, but my daughter, Becky, will be at the new employee orientation. She's going to take a temporary on-call job at Juvenile where she studied up for. So, Kevin, I'm hoping you can welcome her appropriately. She doesn't like to be embarrassed, but if you have to do it, you just have to.
I'll have to think of something, Sam.
So where's she going to be?
Juvenile, and I'm not
sure.
Yeah,
said,
the new orientation on Monday.
Oh, she's going to be at the orientation, the employee
She'll
orientation.
Be at the orientation
Got
and then
it.
Be
okay.
on call in a temporary for and see if that's something that she might enjoy or be good at.
Very nice.
She's excited about it.
Well, good for her.
But I'm sorry I missed my opportunity. It's the way it goes.
Well, you'll have to give me some inside information.
It always works that way, doesn't it? So anything else? I'm thinking you have that Elkhorn meeting coming up. We had, I thought, a fairly productive meeting yesterday with the Forest Service.
Yeah, that.
Talking about potential partnerships to help re-energize the canyon economically. Want to, any thoughts on that?
We had the regional guy or whatever his position is out of Springfield, and very good, I thought, very positive attitudes towards cooperation and collaboration of how we can use the limited resources to work on projects up there. It's been a challenge this summer, obviously, with the fires and the drought. In fact, if you saw the front page of the Statesman Journal this morning, again, it was on the front page. The lake up there is bone dry. We don't see any water coming, and we're going to have some extreme challenges for our agricultural business if we don't get that water.
I wanted to ask you, Kevin. So the bits of rain we did have had you couldn't even see it, or
yeah,
no
just
effect.
The trees, the ground, and the trees are just sucking it up. It's
fire danger is gone, perhaps.
It helped the fire danger, but I don't think it helped any kind of volume of water coming down. So, but they're good partners, and I'm glad that they were here yesterday. Community Services and myself are going to get together on a monthly basis and start having accountability towards where we're moving forward.
Good.
And we'll keep both of you up to date on how those meetings go.
Sounds perfect. And then we also, all three of us, were at the Solid Waste Management Advisory Council last night. And Commissioner, that was sort of your impetus there to have us get that group engaged in helping us sort out where the future lies for solid waste.
So are you upset that I made you sit for 2 hours talking about garbage? Was that the real issue?
No, it was the last 25 minutes that were over where the agenda was supposed to have gone.
We went through the whole system, and I'm not going to put the viewing public through 2 hours of it, but I thought it was a good demonstration of just how comprehensive and modern, advanced, even with the 30-year-old system, in terms of the garbage burner here in Marion County, and I'm proud about that. Trying to bring everybody, ourselves included, up to speed, noting there'll be garbage issues to deal with and talk about within the next 2 years, I'm sure, as we run out on our contract with Covanta, and what are we going to do? And I just wanted to get everybody with a basis to be able to make decisions for the future. So we'll have a second part and perhaps talk about some of those things that are out there that might be different that we want to consider. But if you caught the one part, February 16th, we have to make a decision
Notice
on extending
renew.
The contract.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we've got 2 years left, and that begs a number of questions. So
right. That would be good to put a timeline together, too. I think in addition to the policy discussions, to show people where we're at now and what decision points have to happen at what point. So.
I don't know if I can do that, but I know one.
Barb will. We'll have Barb help me with that. And Jeff, maybe. All right.
I was not bored at all, Sam.
Oh,
I really, you know, and it's an area that we need to be very proud of. And, you know, you've been a part of that. I taken the master recycling class. I knew some before I did that. But just seeing the whole system last night and hearing it from the professionals and from the lay people and from our staff on how they have put this program and continue to operate it. But we also have some challenges that we didn't probably highlight last night that we've got to deal with. I thought one thing for me that was very, I don't know the details of the contract, but when I looked at, is it Tracy or from Covanta?
Darby.
He had those bullet points of that contract, and we've got a whole lot of obligation there with the little return that we get on that existing contract now. So I just thought that was pretty interesting.
If I could add one thing, and kind of hinted about it, but maybe never talked officially with you about it, is that I would really like to elevate our solid waste committee to be able to really make real recommendations to us. I would like them to be able to hold hearings and come up just like the Planning Commission and kind of fulfill what they should have been from the very beginning, not just a group that talks about issues, but actually has a role and moves different ideas forward.
Kind of like where we were with EDAP.
Yes.
You know, I mean, just really educating them and getting them really plugged into the whole bigger picture and starting to happen at that level. And I think I hear what you're saying at this level would be good. And I'm going to follow up with Joe Fowler. He's my neighbor, and just see, you know, he's been there for three meetings, mm-hmm. I think, and just see what Joe's, you know, vision and, you know, is he just sitting there or is he, you know, he's a smart thinker.
Yeah, that isn't what I want to happen. I want active participation.
Yeah.
Yep. That's why we're going to structure it next time with a little bit more.
Oh, fine.
All right. Okay. Anything else?
Nope. I'll be on vacation. I guess that makes me happy.
Just bring us back some good fish.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah.
Plan on it.
Fish and grandbabies.
Christmas.
Oh, really?
We're adjourned. Oh, yeah. I'm going to go see the Brockster tonight.
The Brockster.
I'm disappointed.